Before asking the chairman of the AU to speak, which I will do in a moment, and I'm still getting used to calling her that, having known her as foreign minister, home minister, and even as health minister in South Africa. So this extraordinarily distinguished woman who's joining us tonight, Dr. Dlamini Zuma, is someone who I think we are all thrilled to have with us. But just before we get to that, I just want to ask Dr. P. Setti, who is one of our two sort of hosts and supporters here tonight, if I may, to come up and just say a word of introduction.
Thank you, Lord Macron, and welcome to the Royal Society of Medicine. And it's my privilege on behalf of our president, Professor Sir Michael Rawlins, to welcome you here this evening. Many of you may have been to previous successful RAS lectures here at the RSM. But for those of you that are perhaps new to the RSM, I think I just might mention that we're an educational organization. We've been around for over 200 years now, and we're still going strong. There are 59 sections of the organization covering all aspects of medicine, healthcare, and associated disciplines. And we have a particular interest in what goes on in Africa. And I personally have been involved in leading the global health activities here at the RSM. And so it's a very special privilege for me to be able to welcome you here this evening, both as a member of the Royal African Society and on behalf of the President and Council of the RSM. So welcome, and I hope you all enjoy the evening. Before I leave, can I remind people to turn off their mobile phones? They can be extremely irritating. And should the fire alarm go off, it is actually real. There are no tests planned. And you would exit either by doors to the front of the auditorium, or there's also a door at the back, and get out of the place as quickly as possible. Hopefully that won't come to pass. Thank you, Lord Macron.
Well, thank you very much to one of our two hosts, and let me just thank our other sponsor, Diageo, and at the risk of offending both our host and our sponsor, say I love to be sponsored by Diageo at this particular location. Coming from, if I again, now to really dig my hole deep with Anne McCormick and Nick Blasquez, my great friends from Diageo here, I come from that school of public health that believes that glass of red wine every night has allowed me to get this far in life, and I anticipate it's going to get me a lot further. But we are thrilled because Diageo, I mean, two institutions, an institution, a company with a greater commitment to Africa, it would be hard to think of. So much of the story of African success has been the improvement in public health in the continent. So much of the story of the economic success has been companies like Diageo, which have increasingly built factories and breweries and plants in Africa and sourced their products locally. So we're very, very proud as the Royal Africa Society to enjoy this relationship with the two institutions who are one hosting us and one sponsoring us here tonight. But the other link to medicine is, of course, our speaker, Dr. Dlamini Zuma, who started life as a doctor, and I'm glad to say, you know, did a lot of her health training at two institutions here in the UK. But after a life of activism against apartheid, for which many of us remember her as a force already in those days, she has held this series of extraordinary appointments: health minister in South Africa, foreign minister, where I always used to say to her that when I was Deputy Secretary General of the UN, I was her best friend. When I became a foreign minister in the UK, for reasons I could never understand, our relationship got more difficult. Then Home Minister before now the first woman chairperson of the AU, and therefore amongst the formidable generation of new African women leaders. We had the president of Malawi here just last weekend. We know them all, the president of Liberia, Ellen, who is a friend to so many of us as well. But I think for our speaker tonight, there is a particular title, which is the first woman of pan-Africanism, if I can call her that, leading this extraordinarily important institution. And willing after a busy day at the G8 in Northern Ireland to talk to us about Africa in the next 50 years. Madam Dlamini Zuma.
Thank you very much, Malo, for that kind introduction. I'd like to just say how happy I am. I see a lot of friends, a lot of comrades, if I were to call them that, who were very much in the struggle during the anti-apartheid days. I can see your Lord now, isn't it? I can see a lot Hughes, I can see a lot of others. I can see the former High Commissioner to South Africa. I can see our High Commissioner to the UK, South African High Commissioner. I see a lot of friends, and it's really great to be here. So I like to greet all of you as esteemed guests and friends, and say how honored I am on behalf of the African Union Commission to be here to deliver this annual lecture in the year when we are celebrating our 50th anniversary of the founding of the Organization of African Unity, now African Union. And I want to just go back 50 years and quote the BBC on the 25th of May 1963. There was a report that said, I quote, "Leaders of 32 African nations have set up an organization that will give them a united voice for the first time in Africa's history," close quote. And of course, again, according to the same report, it went on to say its primary aim will be to decolonize the remaining bastions of white rule in southern Rhodesia, South Africa, Mozambique, and Angola. That's what the BBC said then. So the continental voice of African people went through trials and tribulations, but of course has survived for 50 years, and indeed did achieve what the BBC said, the decolonization of the last bastions of white rule. And the OAU, now the AU, continues to act as a collective platform, a common voice, as was said then, and the chief advocate for the continent. It was in fulfillment of this role that the African Union, on the occasion of its Golden Jubilee, which was just a few weeks ago, facilitated collective discussions amongst Africans on the continent and the diaspora to reflect on our past and present, but more importantly, to start looking towards Africa's future over the next 5 decades. So we had a debate, and during this debate on pan-Africanism and African Renaissance, which took place in Addis Ababa on the 25th of May, 2013, Dr. Carlos Lopez, who was the moderator for the discussion from the Economic Commission for Africa, noted that May 25 was the culmination of over a century of pan-Africanism struggles to assert the dignity of the African peoples. It was a repudiation of negative stereotypes and racialist interpretation of African history. It underscored the common commitment of Africans to achieve freedom and end decolonization and apartheid on the African continent. It was about African taking pride in the continent, close quote. Esteemed guests, the 5 decades since the founding of the OAU have seen the liberation of Africa, an unfolding integration and development agenda, and the quest for peace, sovereignty, unity, and integration. At the same time, it has witnessed events and developments which all Africans see as a collective blight on our history. Poverty, disease, wars, famine, dictatorships, coups, and persistent underdevelopment. Of course, during the 50 years, these also reinforce the negative stereotypes and racist interpretations of African history. The colonial narrative about Africa as the primitive other and expressed in more recent references to us as the lost, hopeless continent, dark continent, and a scar on the conscience of the world. These are narratives that have come out from outside about us. But of course, in planning for the 50th anniversary of our continental organization, Africans were and are determined to take charge of that narrative of telling our own story in all its diversities. So we have decided that the first thing we're going to do in the next 50 years is to tell our story. The narrative has to come from Africa to the world rather than the other way around. And of course, I would like to say the first part of that story is that Africa today, across the length and breadth of the continent, there are ordinary stories of the progress being made in many countries, and I think you alluded to that. Of course, a key impediment to African growth and integration over the last 5 decades has been our infrastructure deficit in transport, energy, ICT, and social services. And yet, on the margins of the AU summit in May this year, 5 West African neighbors, Nigeria, I see Charles there, Benin, Togo, Ghana, and Cote d'Ivoire, agreed to invest and expand the Lagos-Abidjan highway into a 6-lane road as part of initiatives aimed at boosting trade and commerce amongst them. So that's where we're going in the next 50 years. Angola, showing the benefits of its peace dividend over the last decade, increased its electricity generation capacity by 50%, embarked on an ambitious multi-billion dollar road rehabilitation program to repair infrastructure destroyed by the civil war, began to make investments aimed at easing congestions at the port of Luanda, and began the rehabilitation program for urban water systems. In Kenya, Ethiopia, Algeria, and South Africa, important progress is being made in innovative green energy projects. The Algerian government announced in 2010 its aim to produce as much electricity from renewable sources as it is currently producing from natural gas. With planned investments of 15 billion euros into alternate energy sources such as solar, wind, and geothermal power plants. There were thus over 800 active infrastructure projects across different sectors in Africa with a combined value of over 700 billion US dollars. The top 10 countries for infrastructure projects up to February 2013 where South Africa, Nigeria, Egypt, Uganda, Kenya, Algeria, Mozambique, Libya, Tanzania, and Cameroon. The African ICT revolution has been well documented and reported. Whereas in year 2000, the continent had only 15 mobile subscribers and growing in one decade to almost 400 million by 2010. And the internet usage in Africa from a very low base grew by 2.5% compared to the world average of 480%. Studies in Kenya are beginning to show an increase in the income of rural households by a range of 5 to 30% since they began using mobile banking. This revolution impacts not only on incomes, but also on innovation on the continent. Thus, Ken Banks from Frontline SMS predicts, quote, strong growth and a rise in local talent and an African ICT sector leading the world in creating socially relevant and environmentally responsible technology solutions. Information and communication technologies allowing Africa to leapfrog important stages of development. This is a key trend that may well hold true in a number of other sectors on the continent. According to Ghanaian founder of the M. Pedigree Network for Pharmaceutical Drug Authentication, said, I quote, much the same way that Africa's lack of significant telecommunication capacity was a boom rather than a hindrance to emergence of mobile telephony, its lack of legacy infrastructure for everything, ranging from waste management to energy utilities, could provide the appetite non-existent in the West for genuinely transformative, future-friendly reconceptualization of the very notion of infrastructure. Close quote. Finally, Africa's story would not be complete without referring to developments on the economic front. Over the 20-year period extending from the mid-1970s up to the mid-1990s, per capita growth in Africa was either zero or negative. However, between 2000 and 2008, Africa was the second fastest growing region in the world and home to six of the top 10 fastest growing economies. Despite the current global financial and economic crisis, Africa has recorded an average of 5% growth over the past decade. 27 of Africa's 30 largest economies grew faster in the decade of 2000 than in the previous decades. Amongst them, 11 African countries that grew at an annual rate of 7% or more between 2000 and 2009. So, ladies and gentlemen, over the last decade or so, and particularly in the context of the evidence from developmental states of Asia, the issue of domestic resource mobilization as a driver of development has increasingly featured in the debates about development on the continent. Even at this last summit, there was a long debate about mobilization of resources. Thus, developing countries are paying close attention not only to foreign direct investments, but also to the efficacy of their tax revenues and domestic investments by their private and public sectors. Since year 2000, investments in Africa has increased from 15.9% of the GDP to 22% in 2012. Though low compared with Asia, this trend is expected to continue as an increasing number of the regional economies are able to tap into international capital markets to help address infrastructural constraints. Investments by Africans into Africa as a proportion of total number of the FDI's projects was reported to have more than doubled in 2011. It accounted for 17% of new FDI projects. Over the period, Kenya and Nigeria investments in Africa have grown by over 70%, whilst that of South Africa has grown by over 60%. Thus, a headline in the International Business Herald of the 8th of May 2013 read, I quote, "Surprise! Africa's fastest growing foreign direct investor is now Africa," close quote. So the study of 50 African countries by the Economic Commission for ECA on public resource mobilization and aid noted that despite challenges of tax collection, tax revenues in Africa have been on the rise, and the average African tax revenue as a share of GDP has been increasing since the early 90s. On the other hand, according to the same report, illicit capital flows out of Africa have been estimated at over $800 billion during the same period, 1970 to 2008. This amount is enough not only to wipe out the region's total outstanding external debt, but also to reduce poverty. And of course, the recent article on the Royal African Society website by Professor Richard Dowden notes that from these illicit flows, corruption money accounts for 3% of this, 30% going through criminal networks, and some 60% of the outflows is tax avoidance schemes. So in order to address this matter, the African Union and the Economic Commission for Africa established a high-level panel on illicit financial flows from Africa, chaired by the former president of South Africa, Thabo Mbeki. This panel is conducting a study on illicit flows on the continent with regional consultations in order to tackle the issue in all its dimensions and manifestations. We therefore agree with the conclusion by Professor Dowden that the real issue for the G8 discussion on transparency and accountability should also be about how to cooperate with Africa to stem the 90% outflows through criminal activities and tax avoidance. And I must say that just come from Northern Ireland where these discussions were taking place. There were very interesting discussions and conclusions. My only regret about them is that they take place at the end of the G8. When they've finished their discussions, then these interesting discussions take place. But I must say that there were very frank discussions about all these things. Because you see, even it's not just the outflows. It's also the contracts, especially in the extractive industries, oil, gas, mining. The contracts do not favor the country. And sometimes you find that the companies have a legal budget, which is more than the budget of the ministry with which they are negotiating. So this is one of the big problems. And then secondly, because we don't have capacity to look very closely at their cost, they inflate their cost and take money as profit, but in the books is written as cost. The other area is that we can't track every stone, every diamond they take, so they undervalue what they've taken. And so all this is revenue lost. And of course, because of all that, they are able to pay even when they do pay tax, genuinely, they're paying it on a low, on what they've declared, which is much lower. So these are some of the real problems that have to be tackled. And the last one, we don't even know who owns the company. Because the architect of their ownership has been made so complex and so opaque that at the end of the day, you actually don't know who the real owners of this company are. So this information is very important, and these discussions took place that we need transparency in all these things. Of course, even in our countries, we need to be transparent. If they pay, the companies pay, the population needs to know what they are paying to the government. We need to be accountable. So it's a two-way. We're not saying only the companies should be accountable. We should also be accountable. Maybe let me just go to another area. And I just want to say one of the greatest crimes of structural adjustment programs in Africa was the extent to which it choked off public expenditure on social services, including education, water, sanitation, health, and other social infrastructures. Thus, Susan George, in her book, A Fate Worse Than Debt, comments on the seemingly inability by the global institutions that impose these conditions to understand that investing in health, well-fed, literate population is the most intelligent economic choice a country can make. So, Africa's human development indicators remain a matter of grave concern for all of us. So this is one of the issues we must be looking at in the coming 50 years, starting now. In 2012, only four countries, Algeria, Libya, Seychelles, and Tunisia, made it to the high development category. And a further 10, Botswana, Cape Verde, Egypt, Equatorial Guinea, Gabon, Ghana, Morocco, Namibia, South Africa, and Swaziland were in the medium category, leaving 37 others amongst the low human development category. However, many countries with a low ranking are still improving rapidly, with the biggest improvements in Angola, Burundi, Ethiopia, Mozambique, Rwanda, Sierra Leone, and Zimbabwe. Globally, in 2012, three-quarters of the 20 countries that made the greatest progress in the MDGs were from Africa. Thus, the 2013 UNDP Human Development Report titled The Rise of the South, Human Progress in a Diverse World, shows that African countries are beginning to make their place amongst the rising stars of the South. As this quote indicates, although most developing countries have done well, a large number of countries have done particularly well, what can be called the rise of the South. Some of the largest countries have made rapid advances, notably Brazil, China, India, Indonesia, Mexico, South Africa, and Turkey. but there has also been substantial progress in smaller economies such as Bangladesh, Chile, Ghana, Mauritius, Rwanda, and Tunisia. So, ladies and gentlemen, let me say, despite the challenges still facing us today, this is the story of Africa today. There is therefore a sense of confidence that we are moving in the right direction, and there is that it is possible for Africa and its people to reach their full potential in the next 50 years. 50 years ago, many countries of Asia had similar levels of development as Africa today. They were wrecked by conflicts, and yet today they managed to overcome many of these challenges and lifted millions of their people out of poverty and into prosperity. Europe, during the last century, itself experienced two world wars that saw many millions of people killed and its infrastructure destroyed. And yet, not so long ago, Europe received the Nobel Peace Prize as an acknowledgement of the progress made in creating peace and prosperity in Europe. So, our generation of Africans owe it to those that went before us and to current and future generations to ensure that we speed up the creation of an integrated, people-centered, prosperous continent at peace with itself. It is this context that we recall the words of the young Kwame Nkrumah, who wrote to a fellow student in 1942, quote, "It is our task," he wrote, "to build, to unite, and to develop." We can only say yes, it is still our task to build, unite, and develop. The African Union, during the 50th anniversary celebrations and the summit, decided on a number of priorities to achieve this task of building, uniting, and developing the continent. The first and overriding priority is Africa's investment in its people. We must achieve universal access to primary education for boys and girls, ensure that they stay in school, and that we improve the quality of education they receive whilst in school. But no society has ever grown to prosperity only on the basis of primary education. The continent, therefore, must have what I would like to call a skills revolution. By training millions of young people and its workforce in formal and informal sectors, in technical, agricultural, vocational skills, as well as university education in the fields critical to Africa's development, including in all areas of science and technology, engineering, agricultural sciences, business, and in the social sciences. This means that we must, in the development of our continent, take technical vocational education and training institutions and universities, and in science, technology, research, and innovation, put a lot of investments. In the short term, we must also fast track the skills revolution through partnerships with countries across the world, including the United Kingdom and Europe, to train African students in those critical skills. Africa's youthful population is its greatest resource, now and into the future, with projections that by 2025, one out of every four under 25s would be on the African continent. That's only in a matter of 12 years. This means investing in education and training, access to technology, investing in their health and their economic empowerment. Given the patterns of youth unemployment and underdevelopment across the continent, more needs to be done to ensure a better match between the education and skills they develop, the labor market, and the economic opportunities. So this is a major area that we have to be going into in the next coming decades. The project of African integration, especially mobility across the continent, is critical for younger generations to enable them to use their skills in areas where they are most needed, irrespective of their country of origin. This matter was raised very sharply in the intergenerational dialogue that young Africans had with the African Union and some heads of state when they called for the expediting and creation of an African passport so that they can move across their continent freely. So you can see that young people are very impatient on this. But investment in our people cannot succeed without paying attention to over half of its population, and that is women. Because women in Africa, probably here as well, and most parts of the world, are more than 50% of the population. And of course, they also produce the other half. So, since the African Union committed to the principle of gender parity just under a decade ago, when the AU was actually established, this principle was adopted at the time. But we must say that just if I were to use one measurement, by last year, 8 African countries have crossed the threshold of having more than 30% of women in parliament, with a further 3 close to the target. We also now have, of course, 2 women presidents for the first time, and we are very proud of that. But this is just 11 out of 54 African countries, and this is far from adequate. But also, even counting these 2 presidents, it shows we are still very far. Because when we have arrived, there'll be no need to count. It will be normal, just as it's normal for men. But of course, African women also make a substantial contribution to the economy of the continent, with over 168 million of them in the active labor market, and also 70% of them in agriculture. And they also running just under half of the continent's small and medium enterprises. And yet they still face a lot of constraints like access to capital and loans, access to land, property, and other productive resources remain a challenge, with an estimation that African women own less than 2% of the land in the continent. So these are some of the areas that should be addressed. Advocating and working for gender parity in all areas of human endeavor and the mainstreaming of women and gender equality in our national, regional, and continental programs is therefore a precondition to the success of African development and prosperity. A third priority for the continent is the development of its agriculture and agribusiness. Africa, we read and in research that close to 60% of the world's unused arable land is on the African continent. But the same Africa imports food and spends more than $20 billion importing food. That can't be right. So we have to do something about that. And we have a potential, really, of growing enough food to feed ourselves and even to feed part of the world. So we need to change our paradigm. But also, besides growing more, we also need to process. And we need to be very much aware of the land grabs that are happening on the continent. And unfortunately, when these companies, individuals, sometimes governments buy these big tracts of land from the continent for agricultural purposes, they just act in exactly the same way as the extractive industries. They just want to grow on that piece of land, pay the workers minimum wage, or even less than the minimum, not improve the conditions of local people, no investments around except infrastructure to take that food to the ports or to the airports. And of course, it means the jobs are created outside. So even if companies buy this land, our view is that what they produce must at least be processed in the continent, if not fully, at least partially, so that jobs are created and revenue is received for this. But this is a big challenge that we have to face. Of course, the continental programs on agriculture therefore focus on investments in agriculture, especially small-scale farmers, and of course for women as well, but also in irrigation, seeds and fertilizers, storage, because sometimes you have enough food for a season, more than enough, but if there's no storage, it goes to waste, and in the next season, there isn't enough food. Transport, markets and market information, agricultural extension services, and general rural economic and social infrastructure. And in the development of agribusinesses and food processing industries of the continent, as well as the development of continental blue economy. Because we have large thousands, tens of thousands of kilometers of coastline, and a lot of oceanic resources, which sometimes are poached by other people. So we must pay attention to this blue economy. And of course, we also have island states, which depend on the ocean. So the fourth priority that I want to touch on is the need to ensure that the current rate of economic growth in Africa is sustainable, is inclusive, and that it creates decent jobs. This will require transformation of the productive base of African economies to enable them to benefit the natural resources at their disposal. We should therefore make sure that in the next coming decades, we transform really our economy. And because we can't keep exporting just raw material, and it is, and we know that an industrialized product exporting commodity importing country is wealthier than an underdeveloped product importing and commodity exporting country. So we need to change that because we are a commodity exporting and importing finished products. So that must change. And of course, Africa's demographic trends are creating new resources of growth. Africa is urbanizing very fast. And there is a fast-growing middle class with a household discretionary spending, which are projected to rise by 50% to 128 million a decade from now. There is a growing labor force. It is projected that by 2040, 1.1 billion workers would be on our continent. Of course, that is also because we are young, whereas the other continents have got older population. And so we will continue to have the largest, youngest population. So commitment to industrialization and acceleration of the African Free Trade Area and other integration initiatives on the continent are therefore critical towards sustainable and shared prosperity in the decades to come. Of course, the important prerequisite to sustained growth is investment in infrastructure and is therefore a fifth priority. This includes priority areas of transport, because if we look at intra-African trade, it's very low, less than 10% or less. Of course, even just trade generally, we contribute only 3%. But of course, if we don't have energy, how are we going to industrialize? So this is one of the very urgent priorities. There are lots of projects taking place in the continent, but we need to accelerate. And researchers tell us that sub-Saharan Africa only generates the same amount of energy as Spain, even though we have 20 times the population. So obviously, whatever I've said about prosperity is not going to happen unless we address this issue of energy. And of course, we must take advantage also of the new technologies. We must not start where the Industrial Revolution started. We must take advantage of geothermal, solar, and other types of renewable energy. Transport infrastructure. Even if we were to produce, if we're not connected, transport, rail, road, air, sea, we can't move our goods across the continent. So this is a very important infrastructure issue. Of course, ICT also, besides the social infrastructure of classrooms, clinics, and so forth. So infrastructure is a very important part. And of course, we are also willing to work with business so that they can invest in these infrastructure projects. And investing in Africa, you do get very good returns. So it's a very important aspect. And I mentioned that there is fast urbanization, 50 new cities with over 1 million inhabitants in the next decade. And unfortunately, most of the current growth in cities is accompanied by growth in urban slums, because we have not really prepared properly in terms of infrastructure, water, sewage, electricity, housing for this fast urbanization. So we have to pay attention to it in the next 50 years. And of course, we need to plan properly. We need leadership. And I think at the moment, the leadership on the continent on the whole is very committed. We need proper planning and execution. making sure that we implement what we have agreed on. And so these are some of the things that we're looking at. But maybe finally, let me just say the African continent, with its over 1,000 languages, its diverse cultures and religions, having prioritized democratic, inclusive, and developmental governments, respect for human rights, the rule of law, and the management of diversity as at the center for development, prosperity, and peace. So diversity must be seen as a strength rather than a source of conflict. And of course, democracy has taken root. I will just show you that between 2011 and 2012, over 50 presidential, parliamentary, and legislative elections were held across the continent. And there's been a drastic reduction in coups, even in violent conflicts compared to two decades ago. Two decades ago, there were 15 raging conflicts at the same time across the continent. And that has decreased dramatically, and hopefully it will end. Though now we are facing new threats of terrorism, transnational crime, piracy, and cyber crime, but we are determined to work with the international community, with the UN Security Council, to make sure that eventually we are indeed at peace with ourselves. So let me just say, these are some of the priorities, and these are the major ones. There are lots of others, but these are the major priorities. But what we have also done for the celebration has been to ask our citizens in all their formations in different sectors to tell us what they think Africa should look like in 2063, which is 50 years from now. And each sector must say, this is what they think, these are the steps that they think need to be taken, and this is the role they will play in getting Africa there. So these consultations are ongoing until the end of November, both on the continent and in the diaspora. So we have started receiving some of the suggestions, and we are going to put them together into a framework that we'll present to the summit in 2014. And the heads of state will then look at it, amend it, and do whatever. But then that will be a guide for where Africa is going in the next 50 years. And whoever wants to work with us would have to fit into that framework, because that would be our priorities. So that is where Africa is going. And in 1906, a young South African, at the time who was studying, Pixliga Seme, gave a speech at Columbia University and said, "The regeneration of Africa means that a new and unique civilization is soon to be added to the world. And we think that in the next 50 years, indeed, that will come true. The African is not a proletariat in the world of science and art. She has precious creations of her own, of ivory, of copper, and of old fine-plated willow ware and weapons of superior workmanship. Civilizations resemble an organic being in its development. It is born, it perishes, and it can propagate itself. More particularly, it resembles a plant. It takes root in the teeming earth, and when the seeds fall in other soils, new varieties sprout out. The most essential departure of this new civilization is that it shall be thoroughly spiritual and humanistic. Indeed, a regeneration, moral and eternal." And we think that whatever he said then is what we are working towards. And a prosperous Africa at peace with itself is good not only for us Africans, but it's good for the rest of the world. So we hope that as we embark on this next 50 years, our friends will be with us, and we are not at this point asking for charity, but we are asking for partnership, for investments, for working together, indeed, so that we, you as friends, together with us, in 50 years, our grandchildren can look back and say we live in a prosperous continent at peace with itself, and thanks to the generations that came before us. I thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. You held everybody with that extraordinary tour de force, tour d'Afrique, I should say, of the issues. We've got a little time for questions. Do please identify yourself if you'd like to ask one. And I don't know, have we got microphones or? We do. Well, let's start over here then, because I see a mic there. And then to this gentleman here second, okay? And if you could just say your name and affiliation.
Good evening, Her Excellency. Thank you very much for that. My name is Priscilla. I'm speaking on behalf of Ben Television London. You've spoken very well about, you know, Africa, what has happened and what we expect in the next 50 years. But one of the things that is plaguing Africa very much as a problem is our inter-Africa trade. It seems like each time an African country wants to invite investors, we would rather get on the plane and spend a lot of money and come to Europe than for us to go to our neighboring African countries and invite each other and talk business and talk the business of investment. What will you be doing in your capacity as the chairperson of the AU to encourage more of inter-African trade so that we can trade amongst ourselves? I appreciate that you've mentioned in your speech there that, you know, the highest foreign direct investor is an African in Africa. But I think we need to do more, because I believe it's only 10%, as I understand it at present, of inter-African trade. It's 10%, out of the 100% of trade that happens in Africa. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Zuma. I am someone born in Guyana, became a pan-Africanist in the 1970s. And my mentor was one Dr. Walter Rodney. I found out when I went out of England that Dr. Walter Rodney, was somebody whose vision of a new Africa was engaged by a lot of people on the continent itself, more than outside of the continent. He used a phrase that, in terms of the future of Africa, it was to build, to unite, and develop. And you will know that Walter Rodney spoke of the underdevelopment of the African continent. My question is that he gave a lecture in Hamburg which talked about enclaves of prosperity. And look at the African continent today, and it seems that it is filled with enclaves of prosperity, which frees out the mass of, shall we say, the poor and the powerless. What I'm looking at now is that we're talking about 50 years, which has had from literally martial resistance to exploitation, to an accommodation, some sort of we can do business. In your position, I'd like you to say, well, I haven't finished my question. I'd like you to say, My question is, what does the next 50 years hold for those of us who feel that the development of Africa has nothing to do with the European economic development, American economic development?
My name is Kops. I'm coming from KwaZulu-Natal, Durban. As Nkosazana have been saying about African development, the problem that we are facing at the moment as African countries, the Western countries, I know there are people waiting for, the Western countries are not happy about the development of African countries. As we heard today, what was happening in the media about what, how they were spying. But my question is not there because it's another political issue. My question is based on African men. What we are African men, as what we are African men doing to support what Nkosazana have been saying as a man, because God give us the power as the men to lead. As the African men who are here, what we are doing? That's the question.
All right, sorry. The lady behind you. Okay. All right, hold on. Quiet. I think in two questions we got the span there of opinion. Correct us.
Hi, good evening. My name is Ifesina Chioka from the African Leadership Center, a visiting MA scholar. First of all, I'd like to commend you and, of course, the AU for their efforts in resolving or attempting to resolve the IBA issue in North and South Sudan, your efforts in Mali, DRC, and, of course, what you've been doing. However, whilst addressing us, you talked about the fact that young Africans are mobile. They like traveling, trying to maybe encourage inter-African development. I was wondering what the African Union, if you have a policy in place or a strategy in place to address the increasing incidences of xenophobia in many African countries, especially in South Africa. I was kind of wondering if you can address what about it.
All right, there are a lot more questions, but we're just going to give our speaker a chance to respond to the issues that have already been raised.
Okay. It's on. Can you hear me?
It's not on. Okay. I'm sorry.
Yeah. I just.
You can hear from me.
My muddy voice. Okay, the first question was about intra-African trade. Of course, I did say myself that intra-African trade is very low, and we need to do something about it. And of course, I also said, what are the constraints, like transport, like energy for, and because to trade, you must manufacture. So if you are not manufacturing, you can't trade. What are you trading? So that's why we are emphasizing on manufacturing, industrialization, on transport, on energy, so that indeed we can be able to trade. But I also said that we are looking at creating an continental free trade zone to also increase African trade. So I thought I had addressed those issues adequately about what we are trying to do, but I agree with you that the second question I didn't quite get. No, I'm sorry, I didn't quite get whether you were saying we want to know what Africa holds for you, for those of you who think Africa's development does not have to do anything with Europe or America. I'm not sure. Is that what you said? Okay. You know, Africa is not an island. It's part of the global community. And the world now is very interlinked. So Africa, with all the things we want to do, but we are not saying we're going to be isolating ourselves from the rest of the world. Europe, we if we trade, we must trade with Europe. We must invest in Europe. They must invest in us. It's an interlinked world. So I'm not sure what you mean by not having anything to do with. And it's, they will benefit, we will benefit. So I'm not sure. That's why I'm saying I'm not quite sure if I knew what you mean exactly. The third one, I think, was not directed to me.
You understood.
Yeah. So the third question was not directed to me. It was directed to all of you. So
we'll answer him afterwards.
And what do we do for xenophobia? You know, the first thing, we must, as I said, invest in our people. Make sure that our people have got skills and that they are employable and that they can then circulate and use their skills wherever they are needed. And I think that way, when you have young people like that who are skilled, who can go around the continent, contribute to whatever development is taking place, we will lower this xenophobia, as you call it. Because there will be jobs, people will be able to, they will not be fighting. It's not about xenophobia. It's about sometimes just fighting for scarce resources. It's not that you are fighting another African. It's that you are just fighting to survive. And so we must move our people from the survival mode to a different level. That is my view. And of course, we also must open up free movement of people so that people don't have to come and hide. Within SADC, for instance, most of the countries no longer need visas amongst and between them. There may be few that still do, but on the whole. In ECOWAS, I remember a long time ago, they launched a passport for ECOWAS. And so opening up is very important. So I think some of the things, and making sure that we create jobs, we add value to our what we extract, we process our agricultural products so that we create jobs for young people. So that is my view in the medium to long term. That's my answer.
All right, I know a lot of questions. I'm going to take, maybe we'll just keep you here and just take a couple more. Madam.
Thank you. My name is Victoria Dimanja from the Democratic Republic of Congo. My question is, Madam, you mentioned several challenges that Africa faces today. And I think these challenges stem from the lack of leadership and bad governance among most of government in Africa. My question is, what is the policy, AU policy toward those governments which have been proved to be source of unchecked power and personal enrichment? For example, the Democratic Republic of Congo, where we have an incompetent and corrupt government which don't protect its people and territory. And what is your take about the Congolese women whose bodies are being used as battlefield for the economic development of the neighboring countries and the functioning of the Western society? Thank you.
Thank you so much. My name is Jefferson Maganda. I'm from Uganda. You mentioned about our young people is the future. In Uganda, we have a population of 70% of the population under the age of 18. Now that's an amazing opportunity for us. But we had a challenge here in the UK a few years ago. We only have, these are not even kids. These are grown-up people from the age of 18 to 24 who destroyed the city. And this is a $3 trillion economy. In Uganda, we have a $40 billion economy of 37 million people. When I left Uganda 20 years ago, there were 16 million people. Now there are 37 million. Expect to be 70 million in about 20 years from now. Question is, I've looked at the policies around East African Union, I haven't seen a major policy in terms of equipping these people. We don't have an opportunity. We can have a time bomb on our hands if we don't do something about it. The question here, what it is seriously measures in place forcing Africans, parents, anybody interested in this world to be peaceful to do something about this particular issue. Yes, we're going to take care of the world, but how? Thank you.
Chairperson, first of all, let me congratulate you for a very successful summit in Addis. I'm the High Commissioner of Mauritius here. Let me first of all congratulate you for a very successful summit on pan-Africanism and the African Renaissance in Addis, which was very successful. My question is really on one of the most important things that you mentioned about shaping the world opinion, which is to take the narrative out from Africa to shape the opinion outside. And if you can tell us a little bit, because I know there's a lot of very good things which are happening in terms of our relationship within Africa and other regions, whether it's the EU, China, India, Brazil, and other parts of the world in terms of diversifying and influence, leading towards, hopefully one day, having a permanent seat on the UN Security Council for Africa, because we do have a voice about how the world should look like, an African voice, in terms of shaping the world, is very important. We should not be inward looking. Africa is a power of good in the world, and we have a contribution to make. Thank you.
The first question, I didn't really want to answer specific country questions, but I will say something about the DRC because I know it. When I first became foreign minister, my first 3 weeks in that job was spent negotiating an agreement to stop the war in the Congo. And of course, the Congo eventually stopped, the war stopped. There was a long negotiations amongst Congolese, and there was an election. And of course, the Congolese elected the government they have. Now, it was not imposed. Now, you may not like it. The AU Commission does not impose. There's a charter on democracy and elections and so on. But in the end, the country, the people in the country, as long as they are given a fair and free and a conducive environment to express their will, and they choose a particular government, there's nothing we can do about it. But if the government comes through a coup, then we do something about it. Now, in the Congo, you talk about lack of leadership enriching themselves and so on. What I know in the Congo, there are real difficulties. One, I think the country doesn't have infrastructure, for instance. You can't reach, and if you can't reach areas, it means you can't stamp, you can't bring the authority of the government in those areas. Secondly, we have to manage diversity in the Congo, but also, there are real issues. Like now, Goma was taken by force by M23. The AU and the UN are working together to try and really get to the root of what are the issues that need to be addressed. And of course, there is violence against women there, as there is usually violence against women in conflict areas. And again, even as I speak to you, I think around the 29th, there's a meeting that is specifically addressing those issues around violence against women, especially in the conflict areas of the Eastern Congo. But violence against women occurs domestically as well. And the domestic violence, when there's conflict, is just extended to outside. So we must fight violence against women domestically, in conflict, wherever it occurs. So there are programs to do that, but you can do it here. There's domestic violence here, where you are living, everywhere, across classes, and that must be fought. So my answer is that if a government is democratically elected, the AU has no power to do anything. If it comes through a coup, then that's when we take sanctions against that government. How do we equip? You said you are from Uganda and you made an example of Uganda. And you say you left Uganda
20 years ago.
When were you last there?
3 months ago.
3 months ago.
Yeah.
Did you see a difference between when you left and now?
Of course, because we moved on, but we have different challenges. Like I said, the population was 16 million. Now we are 37 million. And in terms of competitiveness, we can't even compete with our neighbors. So my job, our common action wealth, we teach wealth creating strategies and we're trying to do the best we can, but the government are not doing enough. And what I see, the policies with the East African Union, there isn't anything focusing on this issue. Everybody talks about it.
What do you want the government to do? Because I think as Africans, we must come with solutions. We must not be asking the next person. That's why in this period, we are saying Africans in the diaspora and on the continent must sit and discuss where they want Africa in 50 years, what steps need to be taken, and what role they will play in bringing that Africa about. So before the end of November, I would like to get your suggestions from this towards Agenda 2063. So that's your homework? Because, well, we all have to contribute. There's nobody who has to contribute and others have to ask questions. We all have to contribute. And so, but I did say to you that in trying to equip the young people, what we have made a priority is to invest in them, in health, in education, in skills. I even said we need a skills revolution for the young people. So it's not that we are not thinking. We know that this is going to happen. The population is growing, and we must. Unfortunately, Uganda has got oil, and I hope they'll be able to use that oil money to invest in the people. And of course, develop the economy as well. So the last question about, I think one of the issues that we have discussed in the AU is about first communication, not only from the AU side, but even member states. Because as you say, a lot is happening in the countries. But it's not communicated. And so we need to improve our communication drastically. But again, you are right that Africa needs to have a voice in the Security Council. We are 54 countries. When the Security Council was established, we were colonized by those who are, some of them were in the permanent membership of the Security Council. And now that that era is over and we are working together, we expect them also to address this matter. We have made the plea, we have made the suggestion, and we are continuing to say Africa needs to be represented in the permanent seat. As a permanent member, two seats if we were to be fair. And we'll keep pushing this. But of course, we have to also make sure that our voice is not only heard politically, but economically. And we have to balance and make sure we improve in our economy so that we are not asking for a permanent seat and our children are hungry. So we must do both. Thank you.
Well, we have a lot of reluctant people in the audience who would have liked to ask more questions. We have a reluctant speaker who would have liked to answer more questions. She's just getting warmed up. But we have to, in order to keep the other events this evening on schedule, to draw to a close. Let me just, before thanking Madam Chairperson, thank Richard Dowden, Richard May, and all the staff of the Royal Africa Society. And you gave him, Richard Dowden, Nkosazana, a well-deserved promotion today. You made him a professor for the night. And we all think it's overdue. Although he's difficult enough as just Mr. Dowden, what he'd be like as Professor Dowden, I dread to think. And from all of us who are the trustees and governors of the Royal Africa Society, our thanks to you for speaking, but to all of you in the audience who've come. And let me just, it's impossible to pull out much from such a rich speech. It was full of so many things, but let me just in closing refer to two. One, this heartily meant challenge to those of you in this audience from Africa, that in the next 50 years, you must make the narrative. It mustn't be other people's. And I think the pushback to our friend from Uganda was a demonstration that that's what you mean. You don't want just questions. You want answers. And you want the debate about Africa to be led by the voices of Africa. And I think that was a very powerful message tonight. The other one is to many of us Africans, but also non-Africans who work here in London. When I became chairman of the Royal Africa Society a few years ago, I like to say that, you know, Africa, that London had become the sort of additional capital of Africa, a center for legal services, financial services, investment, banking in Africa. We'd somehow come back to a role 50 years after colonialism, which was one which has created a lot of wealth in this city, and we see it amongst the membership of the Royal Africa Society. But I think what you said tonight about the resource extraction in countries like the DRC or in Guinea reminds all of us in the audience that we have a responsibility too. We've seen this extraordinary pattern in the last few years with massive illicit wealth accumulated through corruption and violence in Africa, and then protected in the courts of London by the investment banks and law firms and accountancy firms of this city. And, you know, I want to challenge all of you to make the firms you work for behave ethically and properly. The lending of their names to the corruption that has been going on in terms of resource extraction in the continent is a crying shame to the professional services firms of this city. And I think that was, you know, it's not often you get me to praise a Tory Prime Minister, but real congratulations to David Cameron for putting this issue, you know, on the agenda at the G8. And thank you for going and contributing to that debate. So to an extraordinary speaker and an extraordinary lecture, to the chairperson of the African Union, the leader of pan-Africanism today, Madam Dlamini, Zuma, thank you very, very much indeed on behalf of all of us.